Hi. I really hate being bored. So when I was trying to decide what I wanted to do with my life, I decided I would be an engineer. And then I decided I would be a researcher. And then I chose a problem to work on, and I wanted the hardest problem that I could possibly find. So I thought, cancer, that's a good one. It's been around thousands of years, still not solved. So that could easily provide me a lifetime of work. At the time that I was starting my career, nanotechnology was just taking off, and so I decided I'm going to work in the area of nanotechnology and seeing how we can apply it to cancer. So that's what I'm going to talk about today. So before we start, it's kind of hard for me to see with the lights, maybe raise the house lights a little, but how many people in the audience have heard of nanotechnology? Just raise your hand. Okay, almost everybody, that's good. How many of you can give an example of nanotechnology that is used today in medicine? Like, you go to your doctor's office and they're using it. Anybody? Nobody in the front. Yeah, there you go, it's getting a little. One person in the back, and they might just be talking to somebody. All right, fine. And that's a good observation. We haven't made it all the way to the clinic yet. It's still kind of early phases. Now, how many of you could give an example of nanotechnology that's been written about in books, portrayed in movies, something from popular culture, nanotechnology? Anybody? Yeah, a lot more. I see some Star Trek fans out there. Good job, guys. All right, so let's look first at popular culture. Many of you might be familiar with Michael Crichton's book, Prey, which is about these nanobots that they're sentient, they can reproduce, and they're chasing us down. We're not there yet. I would be so excited if I could build that. I would have a Nobel Prize for sure. It would be wonderful. We are absolutely nowhere close to being able to make anything like that. Next, let's think a little bit about The Fantastic Voyage. So this is an old movie from the 70s as well as a book about these nanoparticle or nanorobots that can travel through your blood vessels, and they're going to repair you from the inside out. They're going to have cameras. We can see everything. It's going to be great. This is a little bit more like what I'm trying to work on, but we're still nowhere close to being able to achieve this either, although that is more the goal. So in terms of pop culture, science fiction writers and visionaries have been much more creative in terms of what this might accomplish than what researchers have been able to actually create. So this is the future. So first, I think we should talk about what's so great about nanotech. You've probably heard about it, but maybe it's not clear why it's so exciting. There's basically two reasons why nanotechnology is exciting. The first is you get really unique properties at the nanoscale. And that's because nanomaterials are in between atoms and molecules and a bulk material like the seat that you're sitting on. So they have properties of both materials. They can exude properties related to quantum mechanics as well as properties that you know every day from Newtonian mechanics. So if you look at the picture that's behind me, on the top row are fluorescent semiconductor quantum dots, and that's actually what most of my research is about. These are small particles that glow in the dark. And they're useful because if I can attach them to a molecule or a cell or a part of your body, I can see it. It's like a beacon. It lights up. Oh, yeah, the green thing, that's the thing I'm looking for. So that's basically what we're trying to use those for. If we look at the particles on the bottom, the magnetic iron oxide, there we go. Those are particles that respond to a magnet. So what you see where the arrows are pointing, those are particles, and they can drag the fluid itself with it, and they're attracted to a magnet. And those are great for two reasons. One is they can be an imaging agent, like for magnetic resonance imaging, MRI can be a contrast agent. The second is they respond to a magnet. So I can now move things at the nanoscale non-invasively using magnetic fields. So that's pretty exciting. And then next to that, we see gold nanoparticles. And if any of you raised your hand on products in medicine that use nanoparticles today, gold is a great example. If you've ever, ladies, taken the EPT home pregnancy test so you could know 3 days early, that test is based on gold nanoparticles. And gold nanoparticles change color when they aggregate from red to blue. Blue line, yeah, And so they can be used as a biosensor. And that's a great example of a nanotechnology in commercial medical products. All right, so they have these really unique properties. You'll notice that your seat isn't glowing in the dark, so these result from the quantum mechanical properties. But the second thing that's really great about them is their size. They are really, really small. You can fit 5 million of these inside a cell if you packed it solid. You could see the nanoparticle there in the middle is about 5 nanometers, the ones that I work with. And that is only double the width of the DNA within your cells. It's about half the size of a biomarker. And biomarkers are these receptors on cells within your cells that we want to try to stain to determine if you have a certain disease. So they're going to, you know, like prostate-specific antigen or your PSA level. That's the kind of thing that they're looking for. So they're about the same size as biomarkers. And they're much, much smaller than a virus. So they're thinking about this Ebola virus. They're, you know, probably 1/50th the size of that. So they're very, very small. So the two reasons we're excited about nanotechnology: cool properties, small size. So the ideal nanoparticle for cancer treatment has been envisioned, and this particle consists of a few parts. The first is a targeting agent that's going to bind to that biomarker. So I'm going to look for the cancer cell, I'm going to find it, I'm going to seek it out, I'm going to bind to it. Great. The second part would be an imaging agent, maybe a quantum dot, maybe a magnetic particle, so I can do MRI, but something that would allow me to see the cancer. And then the third part would be a treatment, a drug that I could release to treat the cancer. And this type of particle is called a theranostic because it provides therapy and diagnostics in the same particle. This is still pretty early stages. We haven't really been able to achieve all of this, and certainly not in a clinical setting. So most of my work has been focused on the first part of the diagnostic part. Do I have cancer? If I have cancer, how is my cancer responding to treatment? So we're working on the imaging part. And to do that, we have to work a lot with pathologists. And this is an example of a biopsy specimen for glioma, which is a type of brain cancer that I do most of my work on. And if you're looking at that picture saying, I have absolutely no idea what that is, neither do I, okay? You have to be a trained pathologist to be able to interpret these images. And it can take years of training, and basically all day long, people look at these slides. The way the slides are made, they take your biopsy sample, they either freeze it or put it into wax. They section it into pieces, put a piece on the slide, and first they stain it with this pink and purple stain that's known as H&E. And they look at it and magically say that cancer is there. Okay? The next step is to look for those biomarkers to figure out what type of cancer we're looking at. And so for that, we go to the next slide. And the little brown color, that is the biomarker. And so in this particular case, this is a slide for a breast cancer patient. And we're looking at the HER2 marker, which, if you have this, indicates that you would respond to treatment with Herceptin. OK. This is a little easier to read. However, there's only one biomarker on this slide. So if I want to look at the three molecular panel that is currently the standard, gold standard for breast cancer, which is progesterone, estrogen, and HER2, I have to take three of those. And I can't look at them in combination. Like, are they always expressed together in the same cell? Because I'm only looking at one at a time. Using this method, I can look at one marker. It's usually always brown. Sometimes it's purple. And that's all I see. So the vision that nanotechnology, and particularly quantum dots, are trying to bring to the table is to look at lots of markers at the same time, like this. So if you look in the bottom panel, the original, that's the image that you see. And so these are cells that have been spun on a slide, and we've stained them for three markers, two of which are cancer markers, EGFR and EpCAM, and CD45, which is a normal white blood cell marker. And we can see all three markers in the image, and we can also deconstruct the image into the individual parts. So for this, you would only need one slide. So I've just cut the number of biopsy tissue that you need in 1/3, which is good for you, because biopsies can be really painful. And I'm also able to get more information. I can look at interactions between the particles, or between the markers with the particles. So being a researcher, when I start this type of work, I start with cells in a dish, and I stain the cells, and it works, very excited. Then I might ask for a slice of animal tissue to stain, and I look, and yes, that works. And then I might move to a patient sample. And so this was sort of the process, and again, my background's mostly neuro, so I work a lot with the brain cancer docs. And I'd been working on that a little bit, and there was a lot of excitement about my work, and so then I started working a little bit in breast cancer. And 3 months after I started working breast cancer, I found a lump. So I'm going to take a moment here. Ladies, those self-exams, you should be doing them. And gentlemen, you have mothers, sisters, daughters, wives, girlfriends. You need to encourage them to do them. Because I'm under 40, so I don't get mammograms, and I had to find it myself. And unfortunately, it was fairly advanced at the time that it was caught. So I was lucky because I knew all the cancer docs, but I had to have a mastectomy of my right side with complete reconstruction. I had chemotherapy. I had radiation. Overall, my treatment took about 2 years. And one of the first things I can tell you is that knowledge is not always power. Unlike a typical patient, I was not ignorant. I knew exactly what was wrong with me. I knew exactly how bad my cancer was, and there was no hiding. When I got my pathology report, which, yes, I could read and interpret, I knew what that meant, and I frankly cried for a long time because I knew what I was facing was not going to be an easy journey. After my diagnosis, I went to my research lab, and of course I had to tell them, and their immediate response was, what can we do? How can we help you? And I thought about it, and I said, you know, what would help me most is data. I really love my job, I love my research, and I just want to keep doing it. And so they definitely rose to the challenge. But another thing that I decided was that I was going to change the way that I do research entirely. So when you do basic research, this is the standard paradigm. I come up with this really awesome idea, it's so fantastic, it's going to be great, and then I have to convince someone to fund that. It could be a private foundation, it could be the federal government, it could be my university, but I raise money. Once I've got the money, we all go into the lab, we do the experiments, and we check to see if our idea works. And it works or it doesn't, but hopefully it does. And then we write up a nice paper that we publish in a journal, and then we all pat ourselves on the back and we go have a beer. That was awesome, guys. Good job. Way to go. But the truth is that when we do research in this way, we're not actually taking it out of the lab. It stays on the benchtop in my laboratory, and you never see it, no matter how exciting it is. So the second thing I told my research group is, I want to change the way I do research entirely. I want to do something called translational research, which is really hard, because it adds extra steps into this path. So the new path starts out the same. Got my really awesome idea, I go raise money for it, I do my experiments. But now it's a little different because I want to commercialize this. I want this to go into the clinic. So the next step, I file for patent protection or other intellectual property protection. Then I publish the paper. I can still pat myself on the back and have a beer, but that's only halfway through the journey now. So the next thing I have to do is raise more money, because I need to take this idea that worked in my lab in the mouse, and I need to take it to a person. And I need to do 200 patients, not just one patient, which means when I make those nanoparticles, I can't make a little beakerful. I need a vat of nanoparticles. So there's an engineering challenge as well in learning how to make much, much more of the product. And for that, I need additional funding. Only this funding's not so easy to get. Most of the funding in science is for basic science, not for translational work, because the big idea's already been proven. We just want to fund the big ideas the first time that they're conceived. We don't want to fund the follow-on. So if I'm lucky, I get the funding, and I do the scale-up, and hopefully my clinical trial goes amazing, and the FDA is wowed and thrilled with my awesomeness, and then I can actually translate to the clinic. So this is now what we're doing with our work. And we've basically completely changed the way that we do science and research in my lab. So looking forward, I can say that they never tell you you're completely cancer-free. everyone in this audience has at least one abnormal cell circulating in your body right now that would technically be called cancer if someone actually saw it. So as far as anyone can tell, I am healthy and things are going well. But can't say cancer-free. Thank you. So I'm pleased to still be with you. And as far as the research is going, we've done some limited trials, up to 5 patients, and things appear to be working. And what you see behind you is a sample from a metastatic breast cancer patient, and we're staining for that HER2 receptor. And you can see some cells are white, and some cells are not so white. And that's basically what we're trying to see. And so the physician can look at this and say, well, the patient would respond to this drug or would not respond to this drug based on how white the different cells are. So we're very excited about our research. So in closing, I'd like to say that life is not fair. Life throws us a lot of lemons. You got to make lemonade. And I encourage everyone to fight and keep on fighting. And for me, this isn't just a personal journey. I mean, obviously, I had to fight my personal cancer, but I've been gifted with the opportunity to fight cancer in a way that very few people can, because I can actually create change for everyone, not just myself. And so whatever challenges you're facing, I encourage you to not only solve your own problems, but solve it for everyone else, and go out there and keep fighting. Thank you.